It's a great pleasure to be here, and I should say thank you to Doshisha Daigaku for the invitation to come and speak. And also, I should say how impressed I am by Kawamura-san's inspiration for putting this program together. I think it's very much a sign of the times and very much an appropriate thing, so thank you. I've been asked to talk a little bit about my methodology. I've never had a methodology before, so it's rather nice to be asked to talk about something I didn't know I had. I have worked a long time in Japan, and I suppose that in some ways I have developed a way of working here, which started in Europe, in Britain, but it is distinctly Japanese what we are trying to do now, and to try and find a fit with the culture here. But I thought I should really just give you a brief overview of my background, because when people ask me what I do, it's quite difficult to answer. Because in fact, this is where I started. I was in the middle of the London Symphony Orchestra, and I was a full-time musician. And there I was, where the red arrow is. And I was there for 14 years. But now you're more likely to find me in this sort of environment, on a stage, talking to people. And I work with children, I work with adults, I speak at conferences, I even wear bow ties sometimes, still. And my clients, the people I work with, are really quite diverse. You'll see from here that I work with pharmaceutical companies, I've worked with banks, investment banks, with hotel chains, with household goods makers, and in the center there you can see the Leonardo European Corporate Learning Awards. I'm an advisor for their prize, which is quite a highly rated prize in Europe now. In fact, I was involved in it last week, and we had the Vice Chancellor of Germany who wanted to come along and be part of it. But the reason I've been able to make that journey is because there is an increasing interest in the role of the arts in global society now as a learning tool. And companies are becoming more and more interested in different ways of working in this society, which is now far more complex than it used to be. There are particular challenges for young people, which we discussed last week at Leonardo and as part of a UNESCO conference. And I hope that from the presentation I give you today, you'll get some sort of idea about the relevance for music in particular, and the arts in this particular arena. So there is a new paradigm for education and training. And the things which are driving that are global influences. It's the economic imbalance we face now. It's technology. We all like to think that technology is an enablement tool. It helps us to communicate with people better. I have to ask, just because we communicate with people, does it mean we're actually talking to people in a common way? Interesting, Alex Pentland, the professor at MIT of Innovation and Computing, says that technology, the way it's advancing, if you're dealing with big data, there are about 80% of mistakes occurring in machine coding because people have lost that sense of intuition. So we are losing, through technology, this ability to converse in meaningful ways with each other. And the final thing influenced in the global sense is the interaction between cultures, which is now massive. And people still wanting to retain their cultural identity, but having to actually communicate with other cultures effectively. So as I said at the Leonardo Awards last week, we discussed unemployment, and particularly unemployment amongst the young. In Italy, at the moment, the employment ratio of people who've left school up to the age of 25 is something like 50% unemployed. At the UNESCO conference, we were speaking with the representative from India who said 150 million young people are unemployed. And the report last year from the International Labour Organization did a survey of the issues that are confronting young people. And what they were finding was that the training is inadequate for young people because they are now either underqualified for the work or overqualified. It's a strange dichotomy. So we have to ask, is the training that we give to young people now fit for purpose? And I believe that the arts have a very strong role to play in this. But we need to revisit how we view the arts. And in the case of music, I feel it's an immensely powerful tool. Now, I've been fortunate to work in many different cultures, and I've seen how people approach the arts in different cultures. And I spent a lot of time in Japan. I love being in Japan. I've been coming here for about 30 years. Recently, I had to read through all the textbooks, all the music textbooks for schools. And I spoke a lot to teachers. And there is, I feel, a challenge for teachers. And it's with this word, kansho. And I had to ask myself, what is this thing called kansho anyway? Because we all say we like music. What do we mean by it? Now, in the Shido Yoryo, you see, I have read the curriculum, they've had a go at defining how to include kansho in the curriculum. And these words reoccur. Aiko suru shinjo and kanseo yutaka nishi. Again, the next bit in the curriculum here. Seikatsu wa karuku yukana mono. And this yutakasa to uchikisisa. These words keep reoccurring. What do we mean by that? Mahler wrote pieces about the death of children. Does that fit into this sort of scenario? Shostakovich wrote a piece, a symphony about the siege of Stalingrad. Where does that fit into this situation? So I think kansho is a really difficult concept, and I don't think the teachers are helped with this sort of definition. And I know that all of you have been through that system, because I know how far back those textbooks go. And for me, kind of kansho is a little bit like this. Everybody here, who here enjoys natto? Who likes natto? Put your hand. Right, thank you. Who doesn't like natto? Okay. Now let me ask you, those people who don't like natto, how long would it take for the people who do like natto to convince you that it was really good? 10 minutes? A day? The fact is, you're still not going to like it, are you? So when in the school system, when you're told that Beethoven was a great composer, that's like saying, natto is good for you. You must eat it. So we're really talking about judgment here. There's a lovely story of the actor, Peter Ustinov, film actor, very famous. When he was 7 years old at school, the teacher said, who is the world's greatest composer? And he didn't know. So he wrote down Tchaikovsky. And the teacher said, you foolish boy, you're wrong. Everybody knows it's Beethoven, and stop showing off. So for my feelings about this, I think we have to think differently about the arts, and particularly music. And we have to think disruptively. This way of learning to draw is a technique called drawing on the right side of the brain. And it's looking at things upside down and drawing them upside down because our drawing improves. And in the same sort of way, we have to look at music differently because we treat music a little bit like a decoration. And that comes from the 18th century and the European Enlightenment. And the record companies like this because they've turned it into a commodity. Before the 18th century, music was far more functional. It had to do with the church. It had to do with monarchy. And then there was this whole area, this hidden area of folk music and ritual. And it helped build social relationships. Music has always been about building social relationships. If you go to a Yaku game, you will know who is supporting which team from the songs they sing. So music is much more powerful than what the music industry tells us it is. So I would suggest that at the moment we look at music in these two ways. It's a skill, which we can appreciate. People play the violin, the piano, we admire it. That's terrific. Or it's a service. We listen to music. We play it at parties. But when we want to use it as a learning tool, we need to look at it as a process. Now, I don't know if you know these three people here. Woody Allen, Einstein, Charlie Chaplin. What you may not know is they were all prodigious musicians. So, when I work with music, I work under three principles that really education is about these three things. One is curiosity. It's exploring, it's asking questions. It's asking the right questions, and it's not being afraid to ask questions. In our course at Ueno, Gakuen, we spend a lot of time looking at questions because there are cultural differences in how we ask questions. I say in Americans say there's no such thing as a dumb question. In England we say, oh yes there is, but we still ask the question. But in Japan, people tend to say, I have questions, but I'm not going to tell you what they are. So, curiosity, how we make choices, and relationships. These, for me, are the three most important things about this new educational paradigm. We can go on the internet and search things, but is the quality of what we find appropriate for what we need to do? And relationships, extremely important. And this fits into a personalized learning journey. And it's not just about ourselves, it's how we work with our own inspirations, but in a group context. And the research is there. A man called Lev Vygotsky talked about social constructive learning. Basically, we learn better together in groups. And also, learning by doing. Do we all know what learning by doing means? Do we know this? Let's try you out. Could you tell me what I'm describing here? Any idea? Anybody? I can see people going like this. What's the process? Do we not know? Right, can I suggest you all stand up, reach in your pocket and find something like a 500 yen coin. Right, something heavy. Put it in your right hand. Extend your left hand. Now, question. How do you move that object from this hand to that hand without joining them? Okay. Thank you. Isn't it easier to learn about it by doing it? I could have given you a picture, but actually, to do it, we understand the weight of something, we understand the distance, we understand what it is to catch. Okay? So, yukani ochita koin, shinpai shinaide yo, nante yo, mou sukoshi atu de watashi wa atsumete hokudemasu, daijoubu desu ka? Sit down, please. So, learning by doing is what I'm involved in. And it's also the essence of music making for me, this idea of curiosity, choice, and relationships. When you rehearse, that is what you are dealing with. You have to make choices as a musician. You have to be curious, and you have to work together. And this was a research piece that was done by the OECD, the Organization for Economy Collaboration and I forgot what the D was. But they write the PISA results, the international assessment results. So, moving on, I'll give you just a couple of very quick examples of how we've implemented this sort of way of working. Kabuki. These children are inner city children in socially deprived areas. There are issues around the finances and money for them. There are issues about their social integration. And we did a Kabuki project with them in three cities in the UK. And they made their version of Romeo and Juliet's balcony scene, but they did it in a Kabuki style. Now, for you specialists in Kabuki, you wouldn't probably recognize it as Kabuki, but these kids now know of Kabuki. They know about things like roppo and mie, and they know these terms. And what is more, working with this actor in this interactive way, Nakamura Matazo-san, they started to learn about self-confidence and self-worth and how to present. So it was a very powerful project that we did, and we ended up by performing it at the British Museum and at the Japanese Embassy in London. And this is the world that our young people have to go into. I talked about the way we train them. Companies can't find the right sort of people, and one of the reasons for that is the way that we train our young people. And it's not just about young people. This is a quote from a research paper from people I'm in contact with at Stockholm University, who did a research project working with policemen and soldiers in the armed forces. And they found that working in an arts-based way created a much better sense of well-being, much better integration, much better communication between the leaders and their subordinates. And this was one of the findings they came up with. I talked about Leonardo. This was our Leonardo event last week. We wanted to be provocative to all these executives. We had 200 executives, chief executives, there were politicians and some of the top academics around Europe. And we provoked them with ideas of Leonardo. This is an idea that Leonardo had for building a bridge out of sticks. So we used the sticks for a Renaissance stick dance. And we got them to think about how they use these tools in different ways and how they connected with Leonardo. We got them to build bridges together. Remember about working together. Of course, the engineers at one table had to do the bigger bridge than everybody else. And this person actually is the global learning officer for McKinsey. He is responsible for about 270,000 people. So it's a very powerful way of working with people. So if I can just return to this model once again about this global relevance for working with these three pillars, I think there's a bigger model, and it's one certainly that I work with. If we transfer it into that sort of format, we can also talk about the creation of areas of trust and permission. And they all function together through curiosity. Because you can't be creative in a situation where there is no trust or there's no permission. So that's trusting yourself. You know that people trust you. You give yourself permission to do things. You know people are giving you permission as well. And these at the top tend to be more about personal skills based on how we act as an individual. At the bottom, it's more about environment and the sort of scenarios in which we work. So the people are involved with that. It's the situation that you're involved with. And we have also this idea of when I design projects, I think very carefully about the context and what the purpose of the project is. And of course, this can all slip into this idea of globality. So I'll leave you with two quotes before I go. One is from somebody you might recognize. This was from a television interview he did. quite a profound statement for a president. And he's very knowledgeable about music, actually. I was surprised. And he knows everything from rap to Palestrina. His extraordinary knowledge. And my final thought is this, that actually, when we are creative, it's not about finding new lands to go to. It's about looking at things with new eyes and turning them upside down. Arigato gozaimasu.